Paalam. I take great pleasure in welcoming you all to our Anubhav festival. This year's festival is titled Vadya Anubhavam, which will be focusing on the wonderful great instruments of Carnatic music. The conference will basically focus on an extensive study of musical instruments from the perspective of history, construction, playing technique, practice, style, scope, adaptation in other genres, innovation, concert presentation, and listening approach for the audience. This is the basic guidelines which we are following every day in terms of the presentation. Today we are very, very honored to have with us our conference chairperson himself giving the presentation today, Dr.Sriram Parasuram. We are really very honored, I would say, because as we're also discussing with somebody here, not everybody is endowed with a gift of great musicalship, as well as communication, as well as scholarship, and everything all rolled into one. And that is none other than Dr.Sriram Parasuram, who's here. Violin, as we all know, has been adapted and adopted from the Western music system, but so many modifications have been done to make it ideally suitable for our Carnatic music system in terms of the posture, in terms of the style, in terms of the techniques, and so many other things are there. So today we look forward to a very enlightening session by Dr.Sriram Parasuram. Thank you very much.
Mm-hmm. Om Sri Guru Bhyo Namaha. Welcome to one and all. I am extremely honored and happy to be here as part of this very wonderful Anubhava festival, which is celebrating the glory of the musical instruments that lend so much of life to our great Carnatic music tradition. இப்போ நான் வாசித்தது வந்து எல்லாருக்கும் தெரியும் இல்லையா, ஆல் ஆஃப் யூ நோ திஸ் காம்போசிஷன், ஒன் ஆஃப் த கிரேட்டஸ்ட் காம்போசிஷன்ஸ் எவர் இந்த ராக பைரவி, த ஸ்வரஜதி. ஃபார் லேக் ஆஃப் டைம் ஐ குட் நாட் பிளே த ஸ்வர அண்ட் த சாஹித்யா. எக்ஸ்ட்ரீம்லி அண்ட் டிசெப்டிவ்லி சிம்பிள் பைரவி, ஆஸ் பியூட்டிஃபுல்லி பட் யெட் வெரி காம்ப்ளெக்ஸ் in terms of its tonality, its gamaka complexity, everything. And to play this composition, what's called cold, as the first composition in an evening, is very, very tough on any instrument. But yet I wanted to make this an offering to Goddess Bhairavi. It is not just a story of yesterday or 10 years back or your guru and the people in the tradition. Sometimes it's something which spans the entire history of mankind, you know. So one sits in wonder, adbhuta rasanu nund inda adbhuta rasam namak illata nama life e waste. The more you wonder at things, the more beautiful life becomes, more meaningful every seeking becomes. அந்த வகையில் இன்னைக்கு வந்து வி ஆர் கோயிங் டு டேக் திஸ் ஜெர்னி ஆஃப் த வயலின். த வயலின் இஸ் ப்ராபப்ளி த என்ன சொல்கிறது, த க்யூட்டஸ்ட் மியூசிக்கல் இன்ஸ்ட்ருமெண்ட். இட் லுக்ஸ் ஸோ பியூட்டிஃபுல், இட் இஸ் சிக்னிஃபிகண்ட், யெட் இட்ஸ் லைக் அ பேபி, யூ நோ. ஐ கேன் ஹோல்ட் இட் இன் மை ஹேண்ட். ஆல் ஆஃப் அஸ், தேர் ஆர் இவன் 1/16 சைஸ் வயலின்ஸ். 1/16 இது வந்து ஃபுல் சைஸ் வயலின். Okay, the violin, as we know, we all know, is essentially the way it is today is a European instrument, but we'll go into the details of that. But basically, what is the violin in terms of its sounding principle is something which we can understand first. Ella musical instruments leme there is what is called an acoustic or a sounding principle. Yesterday in the veena we saw it was two gourds. Essentially there are hundreds and hundreds of variations. Essentially it's a string which is plucked, the sound vibration of that frequency of the overtones being magnified and amplified by a sound box system, the two gourds, the sounding gourds. And the suraka sonaliya, the surakkal enna and the sound vandu nam eppadi speaker la vandu and the woofer irukke illaya, we have seen, you know, the big speaker and the space behind it, it's called a woofer. That is what actually produces the amplifies the vibration of the string. So the principle in the veena is that of a plucked frequency string. What is the principle? Like nam naalu, we spoke about the organology of the four kinds of acoustic instruments, you know, the avanadvadya, which is, we will look into that later, the percussion instruments with skin membrane like the kanjira, mridangam, etc. Then you have the sushiravadya, which are aerophones, where the sushira, the air flowing through a column, creates frequencies, and the modulation of that is what a flute or a nadaswaram or so many hundreds of instruments, sushira vadya. This particular instrument comes under what is called chordophones, vibrating string, where the vibrating string is the principle for the musical production. Then you have, of course, the tatavadya. Tatavadyas are those where metals, gongs, like the jalra, like the kinnaram, like the Indonesian gamelan, like the temple bell. The temple bell is also an instrument. Or if the cymbal on the drums is a musical instrument, which is a tatavadya, where you hit on a metal, the metal vibrates, and that is what the sounding is. So andha vidathile vandu the violin is actually a plucked instrument. Can you believe that? How many of you believe if somebody were to tell you that a violin is a plucked instrument? Anybody for that? Okay, orthar okay solrar. One of them agrees with me. Usually vandu the bowed instrument solva illa bowed instrument, but the principle of a bow is something which I will tell you now. The bow, for example, consists of a grouping of hair or fiber. The white are clear, that is horse hair. When the horse hair grips the string, because of the friction between the string and the horse hair, can you hear that friction? As I put pressure, there is friction. When that friction is released, the string vibrates. So the string is actually being plucked and released. But because there are about 250 hairs of a horse tail on my bow, this happens 250 times a second. So it gives the illusion of a continuous sound. Actually, it is the string being plucked. Because of the tension of the string, because we are plucking it in a plane which is perpendicular to the plane of the string. String vandu ipdi poyindu irukku, perpendicular na ellarkume theriyuma illaya, oru alavukku 90 degrees namakku theriyum. Perpendicular na the bow is at 90 degrees. So na pidichu ilukkarappo the string gets displaced. But because of the elasticity tension of the string, it goes back to its original tension between the two points where it is suspended. So this is happening 250 times a second. It's a little difficult to imagine, but that is actually the reality of the whole thing. This happens so often. So that is why, because of what is called persistence of hearing, we cannot distinguish that there are 250 pluckings happening in a second. That's why it seems like continuous sound. It's like a film. Film la vandu, if you see 30 frames go past, 30 individual pictures go past a second, you think it is actually a moving film. But actually it's a succession of still pictures. The same principle, this persistence of hearing la, if you had the hearing of Ishwara, if God were to listen to a violin, he will be able to make out the 250 individual pluckings in the second. So the bowed instrument is probably in some ways a later development from the single string. Nama nethiki paathom iktara, from the archer's bow, the one string, if you pluck it, it creates disturbance in the air that surrounds it, and that is actually what the frequency is. So that is from the iktara. Through different stages we come to different kinds of bowed instruments in different places of the world. Ravana hata, no, an instrument we will look at slides later. Ravana hata is an instrument that Ravana is supposed to have played. Ravana is not supposed to have played this traditional veena that we put in his hands nowadays. There are a lot of pictures and reliefs, even in temples, where you'll see Shiva on top of Kailasa trying to crush Ravana, and Ravana trying to please him by playing on the veena. Now, what this veena? Veena actually essentially means a musical instrument. In the Rig Veda, it is the vana, which the word vana is used for, to refer to musical instrument. This later got crafted into veena. That's why what we refer to as veena refers to actually any musical instrument in the Indian paradigm. But anyway, that is a little theoretical. But na enna solrenna, ராவணர் வீணை வாசித்தார் சொல்கிறா இல்லையா. ராவணர் வந்து நம்ம தெரிகிற இந்த ரகுநாத வீணை இல்லை. இட் இஸ் நாட் த 24 ஃப்ரெட்டட் வீணை தட் வி சா எஸ்டர்டே. இட்ஸ் மோ பிகாஸ் தேர் இஸ் தேர் ஆர் எவிடென்சஸ் இன் புத்திஸ்ட் கேவ் பெயிண்டிங்ஸ் ஆல்சோ ஆஃப் அண்ட் இன் லேட்டர் பிளேசஸ் இன் குஜராத் இன் சம் டெம்பிள்ஸ் தேர் ஆர் எவிடென்சஸ் ஆஃப் ஸ்கல்ப்சர்ஸ் ஆஃப் ராவணா playing something like a violin with a bow in his hand. So the veena that Ravana probably played was something, actually that instrument exists as a folk instrument today in Rajasthan and Gujarat and some parts of even Kashmir. It's called the Ravana Astra or the Ravana Hata, and it is still being played. So the historical movement, before we come to the violin as such, is that there is one theory that this being a folk instrument traveled through the Middle East to Europe somewhere around the 2nd-3rd century and became, around the 9th-10th century, it became one of the most important, at the time of the Gregorian chant, where the initial roots of Western classical music started taking place, where the viola da gamba, which is the predecessor of the European violin, and its variations, they started adopting it into the church music along with the organ. So angada vande the European violin takes its first steps. So here, if you see in this slide, they are all actually belong to a family called lutes in Western European classification. So you have the body shape differently for all of them. Can you see that? And above, what you see is they are called F holes now. When the principle of the violin, we will look into the construction also, is the sound box of the violin consists of a top plate and a bottom plate, which is joined together, creating an acoustic space inside with the help of ribs. That inside, the air vibrating inside, the wood vibrating on top, the wood vibrating below on the back plate, the vibrating ribs, that's what actually creates the unique sound of the violin. So the F holes is what actually allows the vibrational content of the air inside into the outside. Okay, so initially vanda and the hole vanda round a irundhathu. Ipo kodi guitars la paatha guitar will have a simple round hole in the center. Then of course the evolution of that from a kind of a C shape into different ways and finally into the F shape, you know. So you will have these two F shape holes which will allow the vibration of the air inside to come out. It's an essential principle of most acoustic instruments, is to allow the air vibrating inside to be heard outside. That is the reason why many people don't prefer to amplify their instruments with pickups, because pickups generally capture only the vibration of the wooden element. A pickup, if I attach, or a contact microphone if I attach to my violin, will pick up only the vibration of the top plate. So the idea of a violin gets lost if you just capture the vibration of the top plate. I always like to you know, for example, philosophically, all sound happens in a medium of Ishvara, what we call Akasha. Even in our tradition, it is the Akasha, the element of the Pancha Bhutala. Akasha is where music happens. And for me, with my violin, my Akasha is the space inside the violin. So if I don't let that Akasha speak, then I think there is a certain loss. So when, even from acoustic principles, that Akasha is absolutely valid. Okay, so here we have the shape of the lute. The last one, but what you see is the viola da gamba. The viola da gamba also had many, many variations. We'll see one more. Can one? Yeah. For example, this is the sounding principle of the F hole. The green, red, and blue signify the intensity of sound that is coming from inside. So the F, it's a little detailed, but we will not go into that. It is a spectroanalysis of each frequency as to what its amplitude is from, as coming from inside. So if you see, the warmest and richest tone happens, the round is little closed tone. The blues and the yellows and the red actually signify the higher overtones. So if the greens, yellows and red imply warm sound, very warm and rich resonant sound. So if you look at it, the shape of the F hole, the extremities of the F hole, the perimeter of the F hole is where the best of sound comes from within the violin sounding box. Okay, we can go to the next one. Yeah, so this is it looks like an Indian instrument, but actually it's a predecessor to the viola da gamba. It's an Italian instrument. Okay, so even though it looks very small, it's an exceptionally sophisticated, creative culmination of the human mind, you know. So it is no less than the design involved in this, the principle of perfection, the principles of physics have actually come to a pinnacle at the hands of a couple of great makers of the European violin. That is the reason why in the last 500 years, 400 years, 300 years, the violin has assimilated itself in every musical culture of the world, both in classical realm as well as in popular and folk realms. There is no folk music anywhere in the world. There is no popular music anywhere in the world. There is no classical music anywhere in the world where a violin does not feature. So what does it say? It says that here is an instrument, of course, with regional and, you know, each country will adapt it to their own music. But basically in terms of sound, here is an instrument which seems to be very overarching and very universal. It is the only Indian instrument which has lasted. It's an only foreign instrument which has lasted in India for the last 150 so years. Also speaks of its ability to assimilate itself into very traditional music making. You know? So anyway, we will go into that a little later. But basically, I look at the violin as one of the elements which is a reflection of the perfection possible by man. Like when you look at the history of mankind, the history of civilization, there are certain junctures where you will say, yes, the wheel was a turning point. The invention of the wheel was a turning point. The invention of the light bulb was a turning point. The invention of atomic physics and E=mc² is a turning point. So in terms of music, the violin is a very big, significant juncture in the history of the musical civilization. So, idhila paatha, for example, this is a violin which is about 150 to 160 years old. There is a top part. All of you are familiar with the shape. This is called the top plate. This is called the back plate. These are the ribs. This is the black portion is called the fingerboard. This is usually made of maple and spruce, the wood which is used. Maple, spruce. There are six different types of woods which are used in the making of a good violin. Spruce, fir, birch, ebony, boxwood and maple. So depending on the each of these wood types have vibrational characteristics for which they are chosen. So which part of the violin, what wood is used, depends upon a history of what is called creative iteration. Iteration is when you try different things. We will go into a little bit of the magnificence of this violin later on, when at the hands of the violin makers. So, and then there is the fingerboard, which is made of ebony, because it is soft wood. It can be shaped very well. It can give you a very, very beautiful, smooth surface. You have the scroll, which is like the yali, like we saw the yali in the veena yesterday. It's a decorative element, you know. Then you have the peg and a peg box. This is the peg box, the four pegs. This is called the neck of the violin. It is grafted here, you know, through dowels. Dowel and dovetailing is a carpentry thing which some of you might know. So it is doweled inside. These are the F holes. These are called the C bouts, because they resemble C. Then you have the bridge. The strings pass over the bridge. This is called the tailpiece. The tailpiece has what are called fine tuners, which help to fine tune the shruti, the frequency of the string. Inside, there is what is called a sound post. Inside, there are two elements of acoustic members. One is called a bass bar, which is on top, on the inside of the top plate, there is a bass bar, which runs about half a feet. And there is a sound post that actually connects the vibrations of the top and the bottom and allows communication of the resonance between the two plates, between the top and the bottom plate. Okay? I'm just simplifying things for you. tomes and tomes and tomes of research has been done into why certain violins sound so beautiful. And because the elements involved are so small and so subtle, you know, the various kinds of spectroanalysis, magnetoanalysis, vibrational analysis, so many different things. Basically, that's what produces the sound of the violin. So we can go to the next one. This is the bow. The modern bow, like we also saw the different bows also, right? The bows are basically a piece of a stick of wood which allow for stretching of the hair. So whether it be a sarangi or whether it be and the road lavashin povane orta and the enna solva adukku kottanguchi and the kottanguchi player, he is also using a bow only. Basically the principle is the same of drawing the sound, drawing the vibration out of the string. The string is in what is called rest state. It's in a state of rest. You have to draw the sound out by agitating it. That principle is what, that is what the bow does. It agitates, it stimulates the string. So adhula vande you have the tip of the bow. This is called the camber of the bow. This design also is something which has been perfected over many centuries. So that's why yesterday I hinted that sometimes musical instruments give the best worldview of the element of design that exists in mankind. If you look at the instrument richness and sophistication of instrument making of a civilization, you can easily draw conclusions as to how sophisticated that civilization is. So you have that. Then this is what's called a frog. This is called the eyelet. Then to vary the tension of the hair, you have a mechanism by which I can make it tighter or looser. The hair will, and because the stick is a flexible stick, you know, so it allows for that give and take of the tension of the bow hair. This is called the grip. Then there's a eyelet, there's a leather grip, etc. Those are all decorative elements. The stick itself is of two types. One is an octagonal stick which which proceeds to becoming a round shape. And then there are others which are entirely octagonal. The cross-sectional area is different across each part of the stick of the bow. Okay? So, basically there's a lot in bow making also. In the US, violin making, bow making is a full 16 years course. You can learn to make in Italy, and you have to apprentice, so it's exceptionally. That is, you make the luthier. The luthier is the person who actually makes the violin and the violin bow. You know, the luthier actually also makes his own workshop, makes his own tools, because there are no standard tools for making these. So the chisels, the knives, the files, the workbench, everything is made, the vices. Vices na idella vechindu work pandra the carpentry mari tha, but it's a very fine kind of carpentry work. We'll go to the next one. So these are the kind of different kind of bow shapes, from the viola da gamba to the present shape. Next one. This is also another instrument which is the, like I said, a folk instrument with the bow beside it. You know, I chose this because the bow shape is very, very, very much like the sarangi, which we play. This is the Kamanchi or a Ravanahata. They are, it belongs to that family of folk instruments. Next. Yeah, so here is a, this is the Ravanahata. This is a musician from Rajasthan. You can see that he's playing it like, I wish I had a sound sample, but I don't. Very, very beautiful. But of course, limited in its scope of fingering and tunes and what kind of music it can play. Basically, a folk instrument. Next. Here again, you have something of the same family. Next. Here comes the man, Antonius Stradivari. Okay. Now, in terms of the modern violin, Stradivari lived from 1650 to 1747. 93 years he lived. And he made about 1,000 odd instruments, all belonging to the violin family. He's regarded in Europe as God, you know, because of the kind of perfection that he achieved. Till his 93rd year, he made violins. Each violin would take, you know, in a year he will probably make only 3 or 4 violins. So that kind of, it is not just making a violin, it was his life mission to perfect the violin. And I can go on for an hour just talking about Stradivari and all his experiments and what all he did with respect to. For example, I'll just tell you that he used to, right from the wood that he chose, the trees that he chose to take the wood from, he would go and talk to the trees. And then he will decide which tree's wood to use. The seasoning of the wood was a very, very elaborate process, very secretly guarded process. The tools that he made, he didn't even teach his trade to his son. He himself apprenticed under a maker called Amati, Niccolo Amati. So many of his earlier violins resemble Amati violins. But then once he got into his own signature style and his own discovery of secrets of, you know, how the violin sounds better and better and richer and louder and more fine and more precise. I will come to that. I will demonstrate how probably this is the most precise music on earth today can be produced only on the violin. That is a kind of acoustic principles that are involved in what finally you hear. So this is Stradivari. He made about 550 violins, some 200 odd cellos and violas. He also made some guitars. Even during his lifetime, he was very, very famous. He was sought after by all kings. Even the kings had to place order and wait for 5 years for him to deliver the instruments for the court musicians. And he was respected and paid. He died a very rich man. Everybody fought for his estate and wealth after he passed away. It always happens. But he was an exceptional he's an exceptional figure in the history of European music. What can I say? His violins have individual histories. Over violin, in the 550, there was a time when I always used to hope that I will accidentally get Stradivarius to play on, you know, because it is every violinist's dream to play on a Strad. All of them have tomes and tomes of histories. That is how they were valued. In today's times of commerce and investment and museumization and archiving, a Strad can you estimate the price at which an original Stradivarius will be sold or auctioned? Any guesses? 2 million? Few million, yeah. The record for a Strad is 22 million at Christie's dollars. So you're not talking, you're talking about probably even an Ambani may be able to buy. You know, so if I had married into the Ambani family, I could have got a Stradivarius. It is not something which is, so because there are only 550 pieces. My teacher in the US had a Stradivarius. And he used to take the Stradivarius even when he went to the bathroom. I'm not joking, you know, because you cannot leave it around. You just cannot leave it around because somebody will pick it up and go. So they are all the Stradivarius. So they have passed, great violinists have played on many of these Stradivarius. So they are also known and famous for who has played on that. So they are named actually. All of them have, for example, the Lady Blunt Strad. The Lady Blunt Strad is one of the best pieces that he has made. Or the Messiah Strad. The Messiah Strad is probably the most well-preserved Strad. You're talking about 300 years of a piece of wood, which is still retaining everything that it was 300 years back. So you're talking about something that has been cared for, that has been through wars, that has been through revolutions, that has been in snow, that has been in attics, that has been eaten by worms, wood borers, everything. You know, because it's wood. So some of the Strads are had to be restored in by great experts. But for example, the Messiah Strad, which is in the London Museum, is one of the most well-preserved. The next one. Yeah, so some of the, he was also a very fine craftsman. So some of the Strads also had inlay work of ebony and ivory, like you can see here. Very, very fine. This ebony work is there. This is called the purfling. If you look at a violin, around the perimeter, here, for example, there is purfling even at the back as a design. Right? So, he extended the beauty of the violin. You look at a Stradivarius and you feel you are in the presence of a star. Because it shines. It shines like a diamond, and the varnish should shine. The work I've seen these in museums all over the world, and I've always been amazed. Angiye paathinde irukkanum thonum adu paakkrathuke evlo alagadu. Next, this is a great figure from the 19th century called Niccolo Paganini. Paganini is considered to be the greatest violin performer ever. He performed to such great achievement and feats that people thought he was possessed by the devil. Such extremely difficult pieces. He had what is called Marfan syndrome, where the limbs grow much longer than normal. So he composed pieces which only his fingers could reach. You know, like for example, so avaroda pieces ella namakku ketale namakku vande ரொம்ப டஃப்பாக இருக்கும். இட்ஸ் ஒரு பீஸ் கற்றுண்டு வாசிக்கிறதுக்கு ஃபார் ஈவன் ஃபார் அண்ட் வெரி அட்வான்ஸ் ஸ்டூடெண்ட் வில் டேக் யூ 1 இயர். அண்ட் தட் பீஸ் வில் பி ஒன்லி 2 மினிட்ஸ் லாங். ஸோ திஸ் இஸ் பாகனினி. இஃப் யூ லுக் அட் த பெயிண்டிங், யூ வில் சீ த ஃபிங்கர்ஸ் ஆர் எக்ஸெப்ஷனலி லாங். ஸோ டு அண்டர்ஸ்டாண்ட் வாட் இஸ் த ஸ்கோப் ஆஃப் திஸ் இன்ஸ்ட்ருமெண்ட், When we listen to Indian music being played on it, we understand a certain element of that scope. we were talking about limitation of an instrument. How, you know, the more perfect an instrument is, the more the limitations will, you can push the limitations further. So the violin is, as you can see, in terms of the range of expression, the range, frequency range, the tonal range, the dynamic range, the precision, the speed possibilities, the possibilities for playing harmonies, the possibility for different kinds of sounds. If you see the bowing itself, there are 20, 25 different kinds of percussive sounds that is possible. So in terms of the, I need a whole day to demonstrate some of the sound possibilities that the violin can do, is so huge. So here is this piece of this violin which is so small, but which can do anything that any other instrument can do. So that is why, you know, it is not limited by anything except your own imagination. It has a certain, everything has certain limitation, but there are some. So the acceptance of acknowledgement of that is very significant. To say that a kotanguchi is also a musical instrument and as sophisticated as this will be slightly a misnomer. Every instrument has limitations. Some of the instruments have a wider worldview of the music possible within them. That is the reason why they are so, they can, I'll play, you can play the vocalese, especially in the Indian context. The fact that it is not an accident that the violin is the preferred instrument for vocal accompaniment is because all that the voice can do, we will also talk about what is gayaka and all that later, all that the voice can do, the violin can do better. That the continuous sound possibility, continuous variation of tone possible, you know, is what makes it a singing instrument. There is no limit. I can play a continuous sound, a sa, a shajja, for 2 minutes, for 5 minutes, a gamaka unendingly. The main quality of the voice, the human voice, is the sustain. In a plucked instrument, the sound dies out, you have to pluck it again. This is a basic sounding principle of the voice. The voice again is very, very rich in terms of what is called harmonic content or overtone content. Here again, the violin comes closest among all instruments in spectroanalysis to the richness of the overtone content in them. I will just demonstrate it. Enna raagam vaasikittu solunga. You can tell me what you want me to play. I will demonstrate some of the aspects of this continuous tone. I don't have to take a breath. If I have good bow control, it will seem as if I am singing endlessly. So the tune of vocalese is like this. Since it didn't come there, I will play it for you. So it is. So it goes on like this. So the idea of continuous sound, you know, whether it be in any genre of music, comes very close to the voice. So that is why you know, sari varada ragam vaskare bhairavi aayidu mohanam. So thank you. So the possibility of a continuous voice. For example, I will play a phrase which is 30 seconds long, which is the maximum a human voice can play. I can sing, you know. Idea that I can go on and on and on. That is very important if you want to play gayaka. In a plucked instrument like the guitar or the mandolin or even the veena, they say the veena comes close to the voice. The people who have said veena comes close to the voice are people who lived before the violin came into the picture. I'm being very objective here. Then, because, of course, in terms of the gamaka content, in terms of certain aesthetic elements, the veena comes very, very close to the voice. But in terms of this basic requirement of continuous tonal variation and continuous tone production, it doesn't fulfill that. Correct? Dikshita, that's why, says differently, Vainika Gayaka Guru Guha Nutapura in Balagopal. He says veena is separate, vocal is separate. Anyway, that's a different issue. But what I'm saying is the violin, that is why, becomes the preferred choice. Balaswami Dikshitar, the younger brother of Muthuswami Dikshitar, is said to have introduced the European violin. He heard it in bands, in military bands, and then he was so intrigued by it. Both Muthuswami Dikshitar and Balaswami Dikshitar were very eclectic in their outlook. So they very readily, without any ego issues or regional issues, borrowed things which were beautiful. So the violin comes, of course, there is a contesting history that Veerabhadrayyan Urtharandar near Mysore about 300 years back. But then that is another, but this is documented, that then it came to the court of Etayapuram. The Maharajas started using violin even for the court performances of dance. And later on, of course, in the beginning of the century, we have had the growth of from the 20th century, 1900 onwards, seems to be the golden period, the century where this instrument got totally assimilated into the Carnatic idiom. You know, from being a very sought after, it replaced every other instrument. You know, it kind of colonized all other instruments. It drove them away. I'm just using these words for fun, but that's what actually happened, where the violin assumed, came in as an accompanying instrument, and then actually even deposed the main artist and sat in center and became a violin as a solo instrument, a duet instrument, a trio instrument. So that is all because of the fact that and the great violinists became Margadarshis and determiners of the music itself for future generations. Whether it be Papa Venkatramaya, or whether it be Rajamanikam Pillai, or later on, of course, T.N. Krishna sir, Lal Gudi Jayaraman sir, MSG, Parur Anantaraman, Parur Gopalayar, Lal Gudi Gopalayar, the previous generation, all of them they determined what the music is now. They are the reason why we play Todi the way we play. We sing Todi. You know, even the greatest of vocalists were impacted by the violinistic idiom within our system. So that is Istak Perlman, one of my favorite violinists. He's holding up his Stradivarius, which is this ex-soil Stradivarius, which was earlier owned by, played on by Yehudi Menuhin. You know Yehudi Menuhin, also a very famous violinist. Go to the next one. Okay, there was another great maker by the name of Joseph Guarnerius del Jesu. This is a violin of his. Next one. This is Pinker Zuckerman, another great violinist, who plays on ex-Viotin. Viotin was also a great French violinist of the 19th century. He plays on a violinist which was... Okay, here we come to... This is Tirukodi Kaval Krishnayar, one of the early pioneers of violin playing. This is, of course, Rajamanikam Pillai, Kumbakonam Rajamanikam Pillai, who's also credited with exploring the boundaries of the violin when adapted into Carnatic music. This is, of course, the great Dwaram Venkatasamy Naidu. Some of you know. Dwaram Venkatasamy Naidu is an absolutely brilliant violinist who brought a sense of both instrumental playing and perfection in terms of tone to violin playing. Here there is the great Mysore Chaudhaya. He played on a variation called the seven-stringed violin. I personally am not a fan of the seven-stringed violin, but people at that time seemed to like it because or nalla or ambience kuduthathu. It gave a nice musical backdrop. So okay, please don't mistake me when I say things. It's just a sharing. I make comments which are objective. It's not meant to disrespect or anything. This is what I feel we have to be honest when we... So we have come a long way from that, the way I look at it. So it's always good to look at the past and our great masters with respect and awe. But you cannot always assume that the best was in the past. The best can be in the present. You know, in a lec-dem at the academy some 4 years back, somebody did mention, naalu style irukku violin la. இதுக்கப்புறம் ஒன்றும் வர முடியாது சொல்லிட்டான். இந்த நாலு ஸ்டைலுக்கு முன்னாலேயும் அப்படி சொல்லியிருப்பா. ஸோ ஐ இன் சென்ஸ் வி ஹாவ் டு செலிப்ரேட் த பாசிபிலிட்டி ஆஃப் ஹியூமன் எண்டெவர். சம்படி ஹூ செலிப்ரேட்ஸ் ஓன்லி த பாஸ்ட் ஐ திங்க் இஸ் அஃப்ரேட் டு ஒர்க் ஆன் சம்திங் இன் த ப்ரெசன்ட். யூ ஸ்டாண்ட் ஆன் யுவர் ஷோல்டர்ஸ் டெஃபினெட்லி, பட் யூ ஆல்சோ ஹாவ் த ஃபேத் அண்ட் யூ நோ லாஜிக் டு நோ தட் மேபி தெர் வில் பி மோர் ஸ்டைல்ஸ். Maybe there'll be better ways of playing. History teaches us that. The Kalyani that we play now, of course, it doesn't negate the value of what is there in the past. But ipo nama vaaskira paadra kalyani vandu definitely idoda konjam sophisticated ah irukku, konjam complex ah, different ah irukku, different ah ve solrome. Let us not judge anything, but we have come a long way, correct? Like if we can accept that truth about progress, like from the time of having floppy disks which held 20 KB. I still remember. 20 KB in the floppy disk. அதுக்கு கடைக்கு போய் வாங்கி அதை வந்து உள்ளே போட்டு அது பெண்ட் ஆகும், ஸ்க்ராச் ஆகும், ஒன்றும் பண்ண முடியாது. And now we have 3 TB, not enough space. Correct? So things will move ahead. In Dwaram, we see the first time when the plain note and the gamaka come to be in very, very good balance. The purity of the tone, the rhythmic value that he brings to the Kriti in terms of bowing, the gamaka and yet the plain note, both are there in his style. You know, there is an incident which people relate that when Rajamanikam Pillai was teaching his student, இந்த மொட்டையா ஸ்வரம் பிடிச்சா அவர் அவரோட வில்லாலேயே மூக்கில் அடிப்புறான், டக்குன்னு அடிப்புறான். அப்படி ஒரு கதை உண்டு. தட் இஸ் ஒரு ஒரு நோட்டு, ஒரு ஸ்தானமும் ஒரு ஸ்வரமும் மொட்டையாக பிடிக்கக்கூடாது, பிளேனாக பிடிக்கக்கூடாது, எல்லாமே கமக்கமாக இருக்கணும்னு. தட் இஸ் ஆக்சுவலி அ ஃபேலசி, பிகாஸ் த வேல்யூ ஆஃப் அ கமக்கா இஸ் தேர் ஓன்லி இஃப் தேர் இஸ் அ பிளேன் நோட். தட் இஸ் ஸ்திரமாக இருக்கிற ஒரு ஸ்தானம் இருந்தால் தான் அடுத்த நோட்டுக்கு கமக்கம் இருந்தால், இப்போ ரீயும் காவும் மாவும் பாவம் எல்லாமே அசன்ட் இருந்தால் பின்ன பிரயோஜனமே இல்லை. இஸ் நோ வேல்யூ ஃபார் எனிவே. தட் இஸ் டோல்ட் ஆஸ் அ எபிசோட், தட்ஸ் ஆல். Lalgudi sir's technique has a lot to do with the embellishments and the ornamentation of the Nagaswaram, in terms of speed, in terms of the Anuswaras, in terms of the Gamakas. A lot of it is inspired by the Nagaswara. T.N. Krishna sir's style itself is based on Ragamurchana, you know, where primacy is given to the Rakti tattvam of the raga. Devagandhari or a Kedara Gaula or a Shama or anything. The technique itself is based on the raga itself, on the music. So yesterday we were talking about how sometimes the music determines technique, sometimes technique determines the music. In the case of M.S. Gopalakrishnan, it is the technique is so powerful that it determines the musical content that comes out. The Manodharma methods that he devised for himself. The violin, in terms of its Gayaka, yesterday also this point came up. Gayaka can mean only one thing. Gayaka to mean that it is the voice of the instrument is slightly escapist. Every instrument has a voice. So where is the question of Gayaka? The word Gayaka means the human voice. So when we talk about Gayaka or Gayaki with respect to a musical instrument, it has to be to aspire to sound like the human voice. There cannot be beating around the bush in that. I'm being very honest. It is somebody's thought, that's all. For me, it's not an acceptable thought. That Gayaka means finding the voice of the instrument. The instrument anyway has a voice, its own unique voice. That is the Vadhya. We call it Vadhya. So that is what Vadhya is. Gayaka means, because the human voice, at least in the Indian context, is considered to be the supreme instrument. You will know why it's supreme only if you understand the human voice. Do you know that the human vocal cords are a collection of 20 to 30,000 reeds in that small 1 centimeter vocal cord, which is the voice box, are 20,000 independently vibrating reeds. That is Dadbhuta. We don't realize that is why each and all of us, everybody can sing the same raga. Why do we all sound different? Because there are 20,000 possibilities, and each of those possibilities have, if you put the permutation combination of the overtone possibilities on each of those vibrating reeds, you come up with a concept called infinity. You know, all of us are singing the same sa. This is F. I mean, ellarum paadala F. Yen ellam ella F and different ah irukku? Because the possibility of infinity is there. Every human voice is infinite. Because it is such a beautiful, it's not created by, this is created by a human being. This is created by Ishvara. So this has to have an element of infinity in it. That is why it is considered the supreme voice, supreme instrument. You know, you can do anything with this. Mariah Carey sings 7 octaves with his voice. 2-1 singers sing harmonics with their voices. You know? You hear Amir Khan Sahab, you hear Bade Gulam Ali Khan, you hear M.D. Ramanathan. That kind of sound never before heard in the universe. Probably Big Bang would sound apdi irundirukum. You look at the absolute sheer, you cannot even begin to grasp the reality of the human voice. So where is the question of trying to say that human voice and instrument, yes, but human voice is supreme by... If Usain, it's like Usain Bolt, you know, and we are all running far behind with instruments. So the instrument always aspires to be like that. Even in Western music, the vibrato, the kind of tonal color, timbre, it all comes from church singing and all that. So the originator of the musical idea itself is the human voice. You know, the human voice has music even in speech. பேசுறதே பாடுற மாதிரி இருக்கு சொல்லுவா சில பேர் பத்தி சில பேர் பாடுற மாதிரி இருக்கும் அது வேற ஸோ த ஸ்பீச் இஸ் செல்ஃப் இஸ் மியூசிக் ஸோ தட் இஸ் வாட் அன் இன்ஸ்ட்ருமெண்ட் அஸ்பயர்ஸ் ஃபார் ஐ மென்ஷன் திஸ் ஆஸ் அ ஸ்லைட் டிஃப்ரெண்ட் வியூ பாயிண்ட் தட்ஸ் ஆல் ஐ எம் நாட் ஒப்போசிங் எனிபடி கான்ட்ரடிக்டிங் த காயகா டெஃபினெட்லி மீன்ஸ் ட்ரைங் டு மேக் யுவர் இன்ஸ்ட்ருமெண்ட் வித் இட்ஸ் ரெஸ்ட்ரிக்ஷன்ஸ் அண்ட் லிமிடேஷன்ஸ் சவுண்ட் லைக் க்ளோஸ் டு த ஹியூமன் வாய்ஸ் What all the human voice can do. If the human voice can do a meend in a particular way, a jaru in a particular way, the instrument should be able to do it. Otherwise, you cannot claim gayaka. If it can do gamaka, anuswaram in a particular way, if it can do kampita, different kinds of gamakas in particular ways, Varali ga should be, you should be able to play that. You should not say, this is gayaka of my instrument varali. No, 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 no. Varali is varali, irrespective of whether it is. So, and the gandharam saxophone la varade. So, adhila gayaka possible illai. They may claim. That is up to them. That is professional. But the truth doesn't change. That some instruments can do a varali ga, some instruments cannot do a varali gandhara. This is, anybody will tell you. You have to have honesty there, that's all. That's all is required. So, gayaka is always going to be, so the instruments, certain instruments, like the pulangural, like the nagaswaram, like the violin, like the veena in certain aspects, can reach out to the infinite scope of, can reach out. So, dhara na na re re na dhara na re 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 na a na. Darbari without all these inflections is not darbari. Correct. So, this mean of the voice, the continuity of the voice, the depth of the voice, the tonal, gamaka is not just moving from one point to the other. Gamaka, Ravi Shankar describes in one, is all that is there in the note. It includes your voice quality, it includes the tonal quality, it includes the volume, it includes everything. It even includes bhava. Dire na na. In Kedar or Namahamir Kalyani, sa ma ga, the ma, sa to ma, and the mean day, rumba, sa ma, and the ma vandu, or rubber band irukkara mari. It's not sa ma, it's not that. Sa ma ga, the mean itself has a tension in it. Sa ma ga, pa ma, pa ma ri. Sa ma ga, pa pa ma. Pa da ma, pa da ma. Pa ma, pa ma ma ri. Sa ma pa sa da, pa da pa ma ri sa. So, idella enoda instrument la enal vaasikka mudiyatta, Kedar will be incomplete. Kedar is the boss. Not whether I am singing or whether I am playing it on a violin or on a veena or on a rudra veena, whatever be. Kedar is the devata here. Correct? At least in the context of Indian music, we have to insist that the raga is the king. Everything else, how you produce the raga is up to you. The raga remains unblemished the way it is. You can choose to describe it in small, imperfect, incomplete ways. Or you can choose and aspire to describe it. Like, you know how the Meenakshi Sundaram Kalyanam in Madhura Meenakshi temple, if you have seen that sculpture. It is, so that is what, you know, the heights of art is about. It's not about a pencil sketch. You can do a pencil sketch also of a raga. But you can also, you know, draw a magnificent painting with all hues and colors. So when an instrument tries to do gayaka, it is that attempt. So you have to be able to try. So the scope of the instrument is that it has to be able to produce infinitesimally varying frequencies. You know the word infinitesimal? Infinitesimal means the opposite of infinite. Smallest possible. Infinite is the largest possible. Infinitesimal, there must be some engineers and science students here, right? So some of you may not. So the word infinitesimal means that which is smallest. So sa to ma povaradhu continuously nalla po mudiyanum. In 100 ways. Mm-hmm. So the ability for jaru, the ability for meend, the ability for anuswara is very critical in Carnatic music. We talk about gamakas, but instrument la vande technically and the anuswaras realize panna mudiyana, you know. Is the volume heard? Is heard? இந்த ஃப்ரேஸில் ஒரு 20 அனுஸ்வரம் இருக்கு. சி ரீம ரீம the role of anuswaras in a raga like todi or bhairavi or kamboji in these big ragas is very very huge. So unless your instrument can do all those things, this is how it tries to go. Because dhanyasi ipdi paadna tha idu dhanyasi chelaveru therinjirukum dhanyasi ipdi paadna tha dhanyasi mari irukum at least today. See, ragas, the interpretation will change with different eras, you know. I cannot play like how Rajamanikam Pillai would have played at that time. It was valid for that time. But like I say, the raga is a living creature. It changes, like how we change. It's living. It's been living for thousands of years. So it changes. It assumes different forms, different dimensions, different contours. So I'll play the five big ragas as a tanam. Tanam is also a place where the percussive element of the instrument, tanam is between percussive and non-percussive. It is not tala yet, but at the same time it has what is called kala pramana. It has the basic pulse, correct? So an instrument should be able to handle all aspects of the musical requirements. Swaram nana vasik mudiyanam, neraval enunciation, sahitya enunciation possible arkanam. Madhyamakala sahityam is different from swara. So madhyamakala dikshitar kriti vaashikiranda madhyamakala sahityam adhi enunciation nama instrument la vara mudiyanam. So you look at the magic of the bow. I will paint the tanam with my bow only. The punctuations, the emphasis, the attacks, the decays. You know, if I play, so the possibility of a lot of variation with respect to, because the bow is what actually produces the sound and the variations there. So it is what produces musical phrasing. So if an instrument is not able to produce musical phrasing, then for our music, musical phrasing is very important. It is not the notes. The phrase num ta ta is the phrase. And the phrasing vandha than Shankara Abharna varum. So instrumental vandhu phrasing perfection vara mudiyana. You know? Color, dynamic color, everything should be, you should be able to realize. Not only in one raga or two ragas. An instrument is something which should be able to play everything. An ideal instrument. Like the voice does everything. Voice sings a film song. Voice will sing jazz. So, looking at it from the pure idea of should be able to realize every vocal expression. If it's a truly an instrument which is capable of that or reaching towards that. His voice in this is what an instrument should be able to capture if it seeks to be a gayaka instrument. Grace notes, the tonal variations of Lata's voice, the expressions in it. When she goes to Gandhara in that, you know, the delicacy of what follows after that Gandhara. So everything, because it's very difficult to describe in words what all the voice does. We sometimes don't realize or the extent of the sophistication of the human voice, the singing voice. As far as Carnatic music, Indian classical music is concerned, I personally feel that some of the ragas, especially a raga like Rasika Priya, a raga like Ganamurti, a raga like Chandra Jyoti, many of these are, especially Vivadi ragas and Rakti ragas, are very, very beautifully captured on the instrument, maybe even better than the voice. Because it allows for that kind of precision. The voice needs much, much more sadhana for that kind of precision to happen. The violin is a very, very difficult instrument to play. Another principle of mine, the more difficult something is, the more sophistication it can achieve. Any musical instrument which requires greater amount of work, hard work and sadhana and learning, that's exactly because it can produce a greater variety and palette of music. So everybody will easily pick up a guitar and play five chords and done with it. I play the guitar, you know, because the easiest thing on earth to do, pick up a guitar and play. But nobody will tell you I play the violin unless they have learnt it for 5-6 years. That is also when we look at instruments, we have to look at, sometimes select the instrument which is most difficult. Because in the difficulty lies the fact. For example, this is my whole world. My whole world of the swarasthanas and gamakas and everything resides in a piece of wood which is 1 feet, not even 1 feet long. Think of the irony and beauty of that. It is both ironical and beautiful at the same time. Is that everything that I do in terms of the swarasthanas, gamakas, the raga, bhava, anuswaras, everything is just this one length. So my world is, of course there are other worlds that we live in. My musical world, my violin world is just this piece of wood and the air that is contained inside. That's all. That's my akasha inside. This is my dharti. This is my physical being. My physical being is here. My akasha is here. So that is why it is such a difficult instrument. The nagaswaram also. Tottadamela abaswaranda. Because the hole is so small. The orifice through which air escapes. And how you have to blow is so difficult. It's more difficult the instrument, the more depth of music it can produce is a corollary that I have. You know? That's why even this is also valid for the voice. Sometimes the most troublesome or not smooth voice that you have, they have proven to be the most beautiful and long-lasting music givers of our century. It's not the smooth and rich and beautiful hunky-dory kind of no problem voices that have lasted. It's because in overcoming the difficulties is where music happens. Great music doesn't happen because it's easy and doable by everybody. You know? So, the precision. There are certain other characteristics when you look at instruments that you have to think about is what is called response time of the instrument. A violin's response time is the least, which means that it can produce the fastest of notes. You know? So a very good violinist, can play the fastest. I can play faster than any other instrument. Any phrase you give me, I will play faster than a veena, I'll play faster than a flute. I'm not challenging, I'm just saying it is a guna of the instrument. So, this kind of speed I doubt if any other instrument will be able to produce, because the design is such it can produce such quick notes with very little response time.
நம்மளுக்கெல்லாம் கர்நாடிக் மியூசிக் பற்றியே வயலின் பற்றி கொஞ்சம் தான் தெரியும். பட் ஹீ டுக் அஸ் பியாண்ட் அவர் இண்டியன் மியூசிக் டு வெஸ்டர்ன் மியூசிக் அண்ட் த வேரியஸ் சிஸ்டம்ஸ் விச் ஹவ் அடாப்டட் திஸ் இன்ஸ்ட்ருமெண்ட் அண்ட் மேட் இட் ஸோ வர்சடைல். ஒன் க்வெஸ்சன் பிஃபோர் வி மூவ் ஆன் டு தெம். இன்னைக்கு நிறைய பேர் வயலினிஸ்ட் வந்து தே டாக் அபவுட் த வர்சடாலிட்டி ஆஃப் த இன்ஸ்ட்ருமெண்ட் பியாண்ட் த வாய்ஸ். யூ பீன் டாக்கிங் அபவுட் வாய்ஸ் அண்ட் ட்ரைங் டு மேட்ச் த இன்ஸ்ட்ருமெண்ட் இன் டர்ம்ஸ் ஆஃப் த வாய்ஸ். பட் டுடே சம் இன்ஸ்ட்ருமெண்டலிஸ்ட் ஆர் டூயிங் டுவேட்ஸ் அண்ட் அதர் திங்ஸ் டாக் அபவுட் exploring the versatility of the instrument beyond the voice. I'm not able to clearly understand. Yeah. What is the scope of violin in terms of being that?
No, it can both coexist. The vadya elements which are unique to the instrument can exist. Like in the speed na vasyane bilahari le, they may be generally beyond the scope of the voice. The range of the instrument can be beyond the scope of the human voice. Sometimes, you know. So there are certain aspects of each instrument which will be unique to that, the vadya aspects. But predominantly 80% of our musical pursuit in Indian classical music is, like I said, a musical idiom which has been established based on the voice. Raga has come out to be, from the times of Bharatamuni to Sangeet Ratnakara to today, based on singing, based on how people sang, how folk musicians sang, how an Ananda Bhairavi sounded. Correct. So the attempt is to, whether you sing or whether you play, it is Ananda Bhairavi. So when the voice is the primary moving force for that music, the first requirement for it to be in a classical idiom, that's how we trace even the history of adaptation of an instrument into Carnatic. Whether it be mandolin Srinivas or whether it be AKC Natarajan, any instrument tries to play the Kriti, tries to play the Raga. This saying that I am exploring the versatility beyond the voice is valid only provided you have already mastered the voice element in the instrument. Otherwise it's escapism. I will tell you the reverse. The reverse also happens. Say, In the Navaras Kannada composition of Tyagaraja, செக்ஷன் இருக்கு இல்லையா, நின்னு வினா நாமதெந்தூர். This is definitely the sangathis Tyagaraja has not sung. These are all violinistic sangathis, instrumental sangathis. These are all dwaram da first vaashidala. Okay, adukapram I recently heard a recording of MS Amma singing this composition and singing these on the voice. So the reverse is happening, where the voice is also trying to do what the instrument did before. It's konjam thaniya nikkirathu, but the attempt is that you are also looking at an instrument. GNB sir's style was based on what all the Nadaswaram did. If you actually go to see Rajaratnam enna vaascharo adaram vandu voice la kondru paathar, and the brika and the speed and the flashes, the phrasing ellame inspired by Rajaratnam Pillai da. Those who have not heard Rajaratnam Pillai should go and listen to it as soon as possible. The greatest Nadaswaram Vidwan ever. So instrumental and the influences also, then they will become part of the mainstream of the vocal. See, none of this belongs to anybody. There is no ownership here. in the musical, in our sense of what is music, everything belongs to only Saraswati. So that it's, once it comes into the fold of the vocal, it becomes part of the vocal. So today, brikas are commonplace. They were not commonplace 100 years back. We know that for a fact. You know, spuritan or gamaka notate pandirka thavara, adukku romba pradhanyam illai, sangeetha sampradaya pradarshini illai. You know, I'm just giving you a musicological reference. Is that it is not very significant. Whereas now, spurita is what we refer to as nokku or gamaka or brika. Is also what is technical term for it is spurita. Suppose spuritam has become probably the most attractive element of vocal singing today. So this back and forth is part of the growth of the musical system. Both of them belong to the same pantheon, whether it be instrument or music. That's why I keep reiterating that these are not two different compartments. They are very intersecting domains.
Carnatic musicians play the violin by resting the violin on their legs. They bend their back. Nowadays some people attach them, stand and play. So why can't they play like Westerners so that it'd be easier?
See, there are two reasons. One is that our music concerts are longer duration. So ninnindrunda avladha 3 manner epdi nikkrudhe whole night la epdi nikkrudhe. So our sense of music making is prayer. It is not performance. This big distinction is there. So, like when we sit for a puja or when we sit in meditation, we don't stand and meditate. Right? So similarly, the posture of squatting in our culture is where you are at total rest. You know, this is actually our at ease position, not what we do in PT. PT at ease na pinala epdi nukkrome adhu at ease namukku illa avalku at ease irukum namakku vande and the standard attention standard is nyavar ka ipo irukku illa schools la adhu okay so but namakku vande at ease position in the chaplangutti okkaradha or padmasana whatever you want so and the position la we have adapted it. So because the length of it is little more, we have extended our right foot outside and allowing the diagonal to be a little longer. So the taller you are, sometimes what happens, if you look at Rajamanikam Pilli, he was a very tall person. So avarodu ni idu vera dhaan varum. I am short, so it comes up to here. Chela vera vandi inda kaala innum push panni ipdi vechipar. TNK, mama ipdi vechipar. You know? But I find it not so suitable. So I rest it on my collarbone. So different musicians have different approaches. Some people, for example, Lalgudi Saram, back is straight. Back straight arna enna arthana, this slightly moves for me. I'm just telling you my personal experience. If I keep my back straight, this moves. So I bent a little forward towards my instrument. It all depends on the person's height also. Enga vechikkaradhu eppadi MSG sir vandu idu irukliya idu vandu inda bone inge vechipar. He will not rest it. See nama kaalukku andha oru kuli irukum anga. There will be a slight depression. It rests very beautiful there. But MSG sir used to move his leg a little inside and keep it here. He preferred the violin being very close to his chin. If you look at also the video, you will find out. All of them have preferred. But the squatting thing is because of the longer duration. And also the fact that you don't have to, in the Western, you have to support it with your chin. Which makes, so you also grip it a little bit with your left hand. Which makes gamaka playing very tough. Inge, the instrument is stable without any holding. I'm not holding it here. It is just resting. So my gamaka is freer. So these are the two main reasons.
Okay, I think it has been a very exhaustive presentation and many things have already been answered in the course of the presentation itself. I request Mr. Mudra Bhaskar, Secretary of Mudra, to please honor Dr. Sriram Parasuram for that wonderful presentation. May I request all of you to please give him a big hand and thank him for that insightful lec-dem presentation. Thank you so much.
the grace notes, the tonal variations of Lata's voice, the expressions in it. When she goes to Gandhara in that, you know, the delicacy of what follows after that Gandhara. So everything, because it's very difficult to describe in words what all the voice does. We sometimes don't realize or the extent of the sophistication of the human voice, the singing voice. As far as Carnatic music, Indian classical music is concerned, I personally feel that some of the ragas, especially a raga like Rasika Priya, a raga like Ganamurti, a raga like Chandra Jyoti, many of these are, especially Vivadi ragas and Rakti ragas, are very, very beautifully captured on the instrument, maybe even better than the voice. Because it allows for that kind of precision. The voice needs much, much more sadhana for that kind of precision to happen. The violin is a very, very difficult instrument to play. Another principle of mine, the more difficult something is, the more sophistication it can achieve. Any musical instrument which requires greater amount of work, hard work and sadhana and learning, that's exactly because it can produce a greater variety and palette of music. So everybody will easily pick up a guitar and play 5 chords and done with it. I play the guitar, you know, because the easiest thing on earth to do, pick up a guitar and play. But nobody will tell you I play the violin unless they have learnt it for 5-6 years. That is also, when we look at instruments, we have to look at, sometimes select the instrument which is most difficult. Because in the difficulty lies the fact, for example, this is my whole world. My whole world of the swarasthanas and gamakas and everything resides in a piece of wood which is 1 foot, not even 1 foot long. Think of the irony and beauty of that. It is both ironical and beautiful at the same time. Is that everything that I do in terms of the swarasthanas, gamakas, the raga, bhava, anuswaras, everything, it's just this one length. So my world is, of course, there are other worlds that we live in. My musical world, my violin world, is just this piece of wood and the air that is contained inside. That's all. That's my akasha inside. This is my dharti. This is my physical being. My physical being is here. My akasha is here. So that is why it is such a difficult instrument. The Nagaswaram also. Thottadamila Abaswaranda. Because the hole is so small, the orifice through which air escapes, and how you have to blow is so difficult. It's more difficult the instrument, the more depth of music it can produce is a corollary that I have. You know, that's why even this is also valid for the voice. Sometimes the most troublesome or not smooth voice that you have, they have proven to be the most beautiful and long-lasting music givers of our century. It's not the smooth and rich and beautiful hunky-dory kind of no-problem voices that have lasted. It's because in overcoming the difficulties is where music happens. Great music doesn't happen because it's easy and doable by everybody. You know, so the precision. There are certain other characteristics when you look at instrument that you have to think about is what is called response time of the instrument. A violin's response time is the least, which means that it can produce the fastest of notes. You know, so a very good violinist can play the fastest. I can play faster than any other instrument. Any phrase you give me, I will play faster than a veena, I'll play faster than a flute. This, I'm not challenging, I'm just saying it is a guna of the instrument. So, the So ellame bilaharila, this kind of speed, I doubt if any other instrument will be able to produce. Because the design is such, it can produce such quick notes with very little response time.
நம்மளுக்கெல்லாம் கர்நாடிக் மியூசிக் பற்றியே வயலின் பற்றி கொஞ்சம் தான் தெரியும். பட் ஹீ டுக் அஸ் பியாண்ட் அவர் இண்டியன் மியூசிக் டு வெஸ்டர்ன் மியூசிக் அண்ட் த வேரியஸ் சிஸ்டம்ஸ் விச் ஹவ் அடாப்டட் திஸ் இன்ஸ்ட்ருமெண்ட் அண்ட் மேட் இட் ஸோ வர்சடைல். ஒன் க்வெஸ்சன் பிஃபோர் வி மூவ் ஆன் டு தெம். இன்னைக்கு நிறைய பேர் வயலினிஸ்ட் வந்து தே டாக் அபவுட் த வர்சடாலிட்டி ஆஃப் த இன்ஸ்ட்ருமெண்ட் பியாண்ட் த வாய்ஸ். யூ பீன் டாக்கிங் அபவுட் வாய்ஸ் அண்ட் ட்ரைங் டு மேட்ச் த இன்ஸ்ட்ருமெண்ட் இன் டர்ம்ஸ் ஆஃப் த வாய்ஸ். பட் டுடே சம் இன்ஸ்ட்ருமெண்டலிஸ்ட் ஹூ ஆர் டூயிங் டுவெட்ஸ் அண்ட் அதர் திங்ஸ் டாக் அபவுட் exploring the versatility of the instrument beyond the voice. I'm not able to clearly understand. Yeah. What is the scope of violin in terms of being that?
No, it can both coexist. The vadya elements which are unique to the instrument can exist. Like in the speed na vasyane bilaharile, they may be generally beyond the scope of the voice. The range of the instrument can be beyond the scope of the human voice. Sometimes, you know. So there are certain aspects of each instrument which will be unique to that, the vadya aspects. But predominantly, 80% of our musical pursuit in Indian classical music is, like I said, a musical idiom which has been established based on the voice. Raga has come out to be, from the times of Bharatamuni to Sangeeta Ratnakara to today, based on singing. Based on how people sang, how folk musicians sang, how an Ananda Bhairavi sounded. Correct. So the attempt is to, whether you sing or whether you play, it is Ananda Bhairavi. So when the voice is the primary moving force for that music, the first requirement for it to be in a classical idiom, that's how we trace even the history of adaptation of an instrument into Carnatic. Whether it be mandolin Srinivas or whether it be AKC Natarajan, any instrument tries to play the Kriti, tries to play the Raga. This saying that I am playing, I am exploring the versatility beyond the voice is valid only provided you have already mastered the voice element in the instrument. Otherwise it's escapism. I will tell you the reverse. The reverse also happens. It's like, In the Navaras Kannada composition of Tyagaraja, செக்ஷன் இருக்கு இல்லையா, நின்னு வினா நாமதெந்தூர். திஸ் இஸ் டெஃபினெட்லி தி சங்கதீஸ் தியாகராஜா நாட் சாங். திஸ் ஆர் ஆல் வயலினிஸ்டிக் சங்கதீஸ், இன்ஸ்ட்ருமெண்டல் சங்கதீஸ். திஸ் ஆர் ஆல் துவாரம் தான் ஃபர்ஸ்ட் வாசிச்சதுலாம். ஓகே, அதுக்கப்புறம் ஐ ரீசென்ட்லி ஹர்ட் அ ரெக்கார்டிங் ஆஃப் எம்எஸ் அம்மா சிங்கிங் திஸ் காம்போசிஷன் அண்ட் சிங்கிங் தீஸ் ஆன் த வாய்ஸ். ஸோ த ரிவர்ஸ் இஸ் ஹேப்பனிங், வேர் த வாய்ஸ் இஸ் ஆல்சோ ட்ரைங் டு டூ வாட் தி இன்ஸ்ட்ருமெண்ட் டிட் பிஃபோர். It's konjam thaniya nikkirathu, but the attempt is that you are also looking at an instrument. GNB sir's style was based on what all the Nadaswaram did. If you actually go to see Rajaratnam enna vaascharo adar vandu voice la kondru paathar, and the brika and the speed and the flashes, the phrasing ellame inspired by Rajaratnam Pillai da. Those who have not heard Rajaratnam Pillai should go and listen to it as soon as possible. The greatest Nadaswaram Vidwan ever. So instrumental and the influences also, then they will become part of the mainstream of the vocal. See, none of this belongs to anybody. There is no ownership here. In the musical, in our sense of what is music, everything belongs to only Saraswati. So that once it comes into the fold of the vocal, it becomes part of the vocal. So today brikas are commonplace. They were not commonplace 100 years back. We know that for a fact. You know, spuritan or gamaka notate pandirka thavara, adukku romba pradhaniyam illai, sangeetha sampradaya pradarshini illai. You know, I'm just giving you a musicological reference. Is that it is not very significant. Whereas now, spurita is what we refer to as nok or gamaka or brika. Is also what is technical term for it is spurita. Suppose spuritam has become probably the most attractive element of vocal singing today. So this back and forth is part of the growth of the musical system. Both of them belong to the same pantheon, whether it be instrument or music. That's why I keep reiterating that these are not two different compartments. They are very intersecting domains.
Carnatic musicians play the violin by resting the violin on their legs. They bend their back. Nowadays
some people
attach them stand and play. So why can't they play like Westerners so that they it'd be easier?
See, there are two reasons. One is that our music concerts are longer duration. So ninnindrunda avladha 3 man neram epdi nikkrade whole night la epdi nikkrade. So our sense of music making is prayer. It is not performance. This big distinction is there. So like when we sit for a puja or when we sit in meditation, we don't stand and meditate, right? So similarly, the posture of squatting in our culture is where you are at total rest. You know, this is actually our at ease position, not what we do in PT. PT la at ease na pinnala eppadi nukkrome adu at ease namak illa avalku at ease irukum namak vande and the standard attention standard is nyaba iruka ipo irukku illa schools la na adu okay. So but namak vande at ease position in the chapalangutti okkaradha or padmasana whatever you want. So and the position la we have adapted it. So because the length of it is little more, we have extended our right foot outside and allowing the diagonal to be a little longer. So the taller you are, sometimes what happens, if you look at Rajamanikam Pillai, he was a very tall person. So avarodu ni idu vera da varum, I am short, so it comes up to here. Chela vera vandi inda kaala innum push panni ipdi vechipar TNK mama ipdi vechipar, you know, but I find it not so suitable. So I rest it on my collarbone. So different musicians have different approaches. Some people, for example, Lalgudi Saram, back is straight. Back straight arna enna arduna, this slightly moves for me. I'm just telling you my personal experience. If I keep my back straight, this moves. So I bent a little forward towards my instrument. It all depends on the person's height also. Enga vechikkaradu eppadi MSG sir vandu idu irukliya idu vandu inda bone inge vechipar, he will not rest it. See, nama kaal and oru kuli irukumanga, there will be a slight depression. It rests very beautiful there. But MSG sir used to move his leg a little inside and keep it here. He preferred the violin being very close to his chin. If you look at also the video, you will find out. All of them have preferred. But the squatting thing is because of the longer duration. And also the fact that you don't have to, in the Western, you have to support it with your chin. Which makes, so you also grip it a little bit with your left hand. Which makes gamaka playing very tough. Inge, the instrument is stable without any holding. I'm not holding it here, it is just resting. So my gamaka is freer. So these are the two main reasons.
Okay, I think it has been a very exhaustive presentation and many things have already been answered in the course of the presentation itself. I request Mr. Mudra Bhaskar, Secretary of Mudra, to please honor Dr. Sriram Parasuram for that wonderful presentation. May I request all of you to please give him a big hand and thank him for that insightful lec-dem presentation.
Thank you
so much.